And my father always said, when you think you like
I have a hard time.
It's time to be fearless.
Now, every bird has a story, and today I'm going to tell you about the lives of individual birds that were fearless, that had lives that really mattered. And I want you to walk away thinking that birds are awesome, their stories matter, and that you can help tell the stories. And if you're already with me and the bird nerds unite, we can, through citizen science and crowdsourcing, help illuminate the world that's important to birds, but also to people. And if you're not into birds yet and you're afraid of the chevron of geese flying over that will poop on you, it's okay. You're in a TED audience, and I know you're passionate about other things. You're going to be generous, you're going to listen, you're going to share ideas, and you want to be a good citizen. And before I tell my bird stories, you need to know that I grew up in a family where the most important thing was being passionate about what you cared about. My parents just, be passionate, David, Peter, do what you care about, and share it with other people. Be a good citizen. And I love birds, and my parents are here. Hey, Dad and Mom. And I hope you're proud. For me, I love birds not only for their feathery birdness, but for the ideas that they provoke in people and how an individual bird can bring a community together and they can answer really important questions that we have about the world. Now this bird, this is a Caspian tern. This is my most special bird. And I'll talk more about the thing that I hope you saw on its legs. It's got those little bands. And I'm going to call this a field-readable bird. When I talk about bird stories, we read the stories through the codes and the tags that scientists like me put on them. Now we have a local celebrity bird known as Al Capone. This is an example. Those of you out there who don't know who Al Capone is, this is an example of an individual bird that brought a community together. And the idea that he represented actually went viral and became a national and international story. As my friend Ron Jakes, who was attacked by Al Capone one morning jogging in the park, shared with the paper, he felt a shooting pain through his scalp. As a surgeon, he thought, I'm having a stroke, or I've been hit by lightning. As I told the paper, I said, I wished it had been me. Close contact with a bird like that would have been great. I knew it was either a barred owl or a gray horned owl, just protecting its breeding territory. It was fearless. Now, the story evolved. More people had their caps stolen. The city put up some signs. It got bigger. The Rachel Maddow Show made a really cool sign. We put the sign up in good humor, as the way Salem is. There's 3 microbrews now, inspired by the owl attacks. There's going to be a commemorative run all about the owl attacks. And it was this idea of a fearless wild animal right here in our community, but we had a good sense of humor about it. Now, I love how Al Capone brought us together. What I don't like is he's not field readable. He doesn't have any markings that if we start to have attacks again in January this year, we'll know it's him. Now, there are celebrity birds that are field readable. You may know Stephen Jr. Stephen Jr. Of the Stephen Colbert Show is the patriotic eagle. This is the idea of patriotism. If you look at his wings, you can see red, white, and blue. The real Stephen Jr. has blue on his wing and a blue 46. And this is an exciting image because an amateur took this picture 2.5 years after Stephen Jr. had been released from the San Francisco Zoo as part of the Institute for Wildlife Study projects. And you can see on his back, there's a little antenna there. That is a satellite telemetry tag. We can track individual birds in real time sometimes until the battery goes dead. So for 3 years, Stephen Jr. flew around. Nobody actually saw him. He went to Canada. He went past Salem. He hung out in Southern California. And then somebody got this picture, and it was on the TV show, and it's great. We know that Stephen Jr. is well and doing, having a great life. He lives in Santa Cruz Island, where he's got a family. He still migrates. And this winter, he could be right past us in Salem. So get out there and try to find Stephen Jr. Now, this bird is a celebrity in the bird nerd world. And it should be known by all of us. This is E7. Look at her leg. She's got the little flag there. She is here in New Zealand in retirement now. And this is a story profiling her life. She was captured and had a satellite tag. She got the little leg tag, and then she did something extraordinary. We had no idea birds could do this. She flew from New Zealand to the border of China and Korea, 6,300 miles in a single flight. No bird had ever flown that. We didn't know about that. Then she rested for a few days, flew 3,000 more miles to Alaska. She bred, she had a family, and then she staggered the world. She flew all the way from Alaska to New Zealand in a single flight. 7,100 miles. flying for almost 8 days, no water, no food, no landing, no ability to land. Talk about fearless. Now, those of you who look at this bird's legs, it's got some little tags on there. This is an Arctic tern, different than the Caspian tern I mentioned. This bird is extraordinary in its migration, too. It goes from one end of the planet to the other end every single year. It breeds in an Arctic summer with a day of almost 24 hours long. Then it flies south for another summer. This bird, the Arctic tern, sees more daylight than any other animal on planet. It's just like really inspiring. How far does it travel, though? That tag, one of those tags records light levels, and we know that this is a lot of math. All you need to know is it's awesome. In 1 year, an Arctic tern flies 44,000 miles on average. One individual we know flew 50,700 miles. These birds live a long time, 30, 34 years. In their lifetime, they are flying almost 1.5 million miles or flying to the moon back and forth 3 times. This is sort of funny because until 1822, we didn't really know where birds went when they migrated, and we thought that they went to the moon. That was one of the leading answers. They sort of fly off and they go away. Another idea, this is some fishermen in 1555 in Sweden, and they're hauling in a net full of fish and birds. And the idea was that they hibernated underwater. And it was inspired by swallows. Swallows will be in marshes, hundreds of thousands one day, and they'll be gone the next. And so it makes sense that they went into the mud. I also get to study swallows. We still have questions about swallows. Now, look at this bird and look at its leg. I know it's a little sad. It's obviously been hit by a car and dead. This is a big ask. When you see roadkill, please stop and look. Look closely, because maybe it has a tag that a scientist put on there, and you can bring meaning to the life of that poor animal that died. This particular bird is part of a cutting-edge study that I'm part of at Cornell University with David Winkler and the Lab of Ornithology there, and we are working to implement tags that don't have batteries anymore. It's just a solar panel, and it goes to a transmitter, and whenever the sun shines, it has a radio broadcast, and we can pick that up. That poor bird that was hit, we knew when she left the breeding site, we knew when she for her winter, and that we knew when she came back, we knew a lot about her life, and we knew the day that she died. She was one of the very first birds that had this tag, so she probably won't be really famous, but she was important. The Cornell Lab of Ornithology has a leading citizen science program. Anything you want to know about birds, you can find there. This is a map of tree swallows that citizens have just said, I saw a tree swallow, and this is where I saw it. You can do this for any bird anywhere in the world. It's a program called eBird. You can do it on your computer or as an app, download it. It's an extraordinary way to learn about birds and to contribute about birds. Now, this bird is the Fehlstork. This is a really important story. Go back to 1822, and the world is globalizing, and it's the age of scientific technology starting to rise. And at this point, we still don't know if birds migrate, if they can go long distances. It just seems impossible. But this bird was shot by an arrow somewhere, probably in Chad. She flew 2, 3, 4, 5 days, arrived in Germany, landed in a meadow, and was shot in the head by the Count of Mecklenburg. This is the famous Fehlstork of Mecklenburg. This is the bird that answered the question that had been around since 1555. Where do the birds go? An African person who wasn't a scientist shot this bird. A German person who wasn't a scientist shot the bird, and the community of science was ready for this piece of evidence, and it was clear that birds could migrate extraordinary distances. Now, luckily today, if you want to track storks, you don't have to shoot them like this. All you need to do is get out your phone and download the app Animal Tracker, and you can have birds in real time right now with satellite telemetry, and whenever they move, you get a little tweet, and it tells you your bird's moving. So check that out. My bird, Caspian tern, is a cosmopolitan distribution. This is me and a colleague working on an art project about where they live. It was trying to articulate connections between South Africa and Oregon. And Caspian terns are everywhere. This is my Fehlstork. This is the bird that one day in 2005, a decade ago on the internet, when peer-to-peer sharing just started to happen, I was looking for pictures of Caspian terns, and I found this bird. 10 days after I had marked it in Oregon, someone in California took a picture of it. And this is a young bird. It's with its parent. It's flying around. And it was extraordinary. It was a data point that I couldn't have got any other way. I created a group on Flickr. And now, 10 years later, hundreds of people have shared Caspian tern pictures, all stages of life, all over the world. and it's extraordinary. Also, many people are now sharing on a companion site birds with field readable tags. If it has a thing on it, people are saying, well, where did that come from? And they're sharing this again. Hundreds of people all over the world sharing birds with field readable tags. So if you see a bird, take the time, look at it, take a picture, share it. It's a really exciting time in the world where many birds and many organisms are being marked. And if you want to contribute, you don't even have to go bird watching anymore. I want you to go outside, of course, but you could sit at your computer and watch Green 99. This is a condor. He hasn't fledged yet. His entire life will be a soap opera that we can participate in. And you can go, and right now, and we're collecting all this video, and then scientists like me will be like, is he getting pesticides in his diet? We'll know from his behavior. You could help code what he's done. As he goes out into the world, you can follow him. Really, really exciting times. Now, enough about birds and for bird people. This is the story, and every bird has a story, of H5N1. Now, this bird here was photographed. It had, as part of a huge avian flu study, and the question was, can birds from remote areas of Mongolia get to places with lots of people? And the answer was yes. The picture was taken by an amateur in India, and he figured out where it was. So this is a way that it connects directly to you. Lots of apps, lots of ways to communicate as a citizen. This is my phone, eBird, Animal Tracker, Trees, iNaturalist. I don't actually track my sex life on the Kinsey Institute app on that lower right-hand corner, but I thought for those who just want to track passion, there's an app for you too. Now, I really appreciate you giving me my turn. I want you to remember, birds are awesome. Their stories matter. You can help tell the stories. And no matter what your passion is, you go out there and you find your story, share it with other people. I've had my turn, now it's your turn.